Christianity can be considered the world's largest religion, consisting of more than 25,000 individual denominations, with approximately 2.18 billion followers overall. Christianity's geographic distribution is quite vast. Not one continent today can claim to be the center of global Christianity. Christianity is the religion of one-third of the world's population. Thus, Christianity has had an incredible impact on society and culture. Since Christianity is widespread, its theology is doctrine to much of the world. This directly influences society, culture, and political institutions alike. Particularly, Christian theology and doctrine influences the status and life of women. The Christian Bible is the main literature that executes doctrine on how women should be perceived in the world. Within Scripture, women are caught in a dichotomy between seen as equal to men or subordinate to men. However, traditionally, women fall into subordination when Scripture is being interpreted. This study will explore the ways in which patriarchal dominance and ownership within Christian theology plays a role in contemporary everyday life of women. Furthermore, the study will be conducted through a feminist theologist lens. Patriarchal dominance and ownership within Christianity often leads to domestic violence against women. Violence, which is often sexual, is experienced by women of all ages. In 1982, the General Board of Global Ministries of the United Methodist Church conducted a study to investigate the presence or absence of domestic violence among its congregants. Gathering data from some 47 states in rural and urban settings, large and small churches cutting across economic lines, the study found that 1 in 4 respondents had been abused by their spouses, and that another 1 in 5 respondents had family members or close friends who had been abused. In addition, 1 in 19 reported having been abused as children, and 1 in 14 said they were or had been victims of incest. In the past, churches have addressed the problem of domestic violence and other crimes against women by specifically creating declarations which acknowledge and combat violence. However, these measures are merely band-aids to the problem at large. Churches rarely address the underlying problems of female subordination within their historical theology. The theological understanding of ownership and dominance is what enables domestic violence room to thrive. To begin to understand patriarchal dominance and female subordination within Christian theology, we must first explore such phenomena in what is perceived to be a universal occurrence. Sherry Ortner suggests that female is to male as nature is to culture. Ortner examines a perceived universal devaluation of women based on cultural assumptions of the hierarchy of culture, which is the sphere of human control over nature, or the spontaneous processes that humans don't originate or control, however highly depend on. In Ortner's analysis of the culture-nature hierarchy, she points out that women are perceived to be closer to nature. This is due to women's physiological investment in the biological processes that reproduce the species, which limit her from the enhancement of herself as an individual. Women's perceived closeness with nature restricts social mobility. Women work in groups gathering food, hunting small animals, and transforming these products, as well as those of male hunting, into food, clothes, and artifacts for the whole society. Men's ability to define women's realm as inferior depends on the success of male hunting and warfare in becoming the link for the domestic units of society. Males then become the lawmakers, ritualists, and cultural definers of society. More highly valued cultural activities are monopolized by men. These often have more to do with ritual and leisure functions than with daily necessities. If women make ordinary clothes, men may monopolize on the making of festival clothes, war bonnets, and so on. Men occupy the sphere of freedom and confine women to the realm of necessity. Furthermore, stemming from Greek philosophy, women are represented by the body and passions, whereas men are natural exemplars of mind and reason. Therefore, women are perceived as irrational and emotional, while men are logical and rational. Not only do men create an environment where women are universally subject to inferiority, men create an atmosphere for themselves to take on tasks that create culture such as ritual or religious leadership. The arguments for female exclusion within religious leadership, and specifically in ministry, are identical with the argument Sherry Ortner proposes. Women are denied leadership in churches for the same reasons they are denied leadership in society. The arguments for women's exclusion from ministry are the applications of the general theology of male headship and female subordination. This subordination, while attributed to women's physiological role in procreation, extends to an inferiority of mind and soul as well. Women are categorized as less capable than men for moral self-control and reason. They can play only a passive role in the giving and receiving of ministry. The most extreme repulsion against the idea of women in ministry typically is expressed in the question, "Can you imagine a pregnant woman at the altar?" Excluding women from creating cultural values, such as working positions like ritual and religious leadership, helps create a space for women to remain a subordinate class. However, what does this subordination look like? Domestic and sexual violence against women is rooted in and is the logical conclusion of basic patriarchal assumptions about women's subordinate status. Various expressions of popular culture assert that violence is the means by which men can stay in control or regain control over, in quotations, their women. It is an offensive tactic that serves the interest of patriarchy. Domestic and sexual violence are both socially constructed and individually willed. Individuals choose to exercise violence, but that choice is deeply influenced by how one experiences one's place in the overall social order. Traditional patriarchal law denied women adults autonomous civil status. Women were treated legally as permanent minors and dependents of fathers and husbands. They had no right to represent themselves politically as legal persons. Their right to inherit and transmit property was also limited, and their earnings were regarded as belonging to their husbands. While there are many biblical passages that could be quoted to offset this view in favor of the equality of women and men in the eyes of God, the message that has pervaded the tradition is that women and their offspring are the property of men and hence subject to man's power. For example, the presence of domination over women can be traced back to Genesis 2 and 3. Most notable and widely accepted is the creation story with Adam and Eve. In quotations, "So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and while he slept, took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man he made into a woman, and brought her to the man." And furthermore, in Genesis 3:16, domination of women is indeed explicit. In quotations, "To the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your pain in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children, yet your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you." Throughout history, laws of various societies have attempted to limit the extent and means of man's control, but the underlying message, built into the words and structures of religious tradition, remains constant. By God's design, women and children are subject to men. Steps to defeat female subordination within Christian theology insist on a conversion from patriarchy. In the public arena, things are changing. However, there is a significant lag in dealing with the private, emotional agenda. A crucial theological agenda in the conversion from patriarchy is the transformation of God language and imagery. Pronouns within Scripture refer to God as He, which create hierarchy that supports patriarchy. Serious feminist theological thought needs to be initiated in order to begin to achieve a Christianity that views men and women as equal. However, it can be questioned whether Christianity will still be Christianity if major revisions are made to the religion.